Hey, welcome. Welcome everyone to this clinic on linking. Well, it's a clinic with a very long name. It's about linking and transitioning between non-contributory social assistance and contributory social insurance, social protection for informal workers and beyond. So, and it's really great that we have so many participants in that clinic session. And so this is not the time for a kind of a long presentation. This is really a session which is really on interacting, on thinking together, on really giving feedback to each other. So I don't want to do a kind of a long introductory speech, but I just wanted to just share some ideas of what is behind that long title and what are the kind of questions that we might be addressing in the clinic. So basically, I mean, we know that in social protection, when we discuss about social protection, we distinguish normally between the kind of the non-contributory types of schemes and the contributory types of schemes. And the non-contributory we sometimes call kind of social assistance, but also there are different subtypes of it. There's kind of social assistance in the more narrow sense, in the sense of kind of, well, quite often means tested benefits that are really targeted towards people living in poverty. But there are also universal benefits that go to larger categories of the population. And when we talk about contributory schemes, most of the time we talk about social assistance schemes. And but also being aware that also social assistance schemes quite often can include non-contributory elements. I mean, quite often they have, for example, kind of they include kind of a guarantee for a minimum benefit, for example, or they have some provisions to, in a way, kind of subsidize the contributions of those on low incomes. So the boundary between those two types is not very clear cut. But then also talking about social protection systems, we know that these different types of schemes need to work together. So this is really about making sure that people can transition between different schemes, that they work together, that they don't contradict each other or set the wrong incentives. And also to think about measures to see that we promote solidarity and risk sharing and avoid fragmentation and exclusion in that. So this is then another point which is, I think, very important to think about is really what are the broader policies and strategies that can promote the extension of social security coverage to those in the informal economy. And I think there is a lot of interesting examples in that respect. And last but not least, and basically as a kind of a cutting point, really ensuring a gender responsive and disability inclusive approach. So, and with that, actually the clinic session, these are really meant as a very kind of interactive session. And I will just briefly introduce who we have here in this session as experts. And, or maybe Quinn, if you would like to do that and introduce the session and who we have on board for that.
Yes, welcome also from my side and thanks Christine for your introduction. I'm just actually looking in the list of participants whether our experts already arrived, because I know that some of them were in earlier sessions, but I actually can't see them. Ah, Laura is here. Luca is here as well. Okay, so I'll just introduce everyone. So we're very delighted that we have designated resource person today for the discussion with us. Welcome to Laura Alfas. She's the head of program of the social protection program at WIGO. Welcome to Yasmina Papa. She's a social protection specialist at the ILO in Moscow. And also welcome to Luca Pellerano, who is also a social protection specialist based in ILO Beirut. And then, unfortunately, we have two experts who couldn't join the session, but also thanks to them because they will be involved later in responding to your questions in the Google Doc. So thank you in advance to Ludovico Carraro from Oxford Policy Management and to Nuno Cunha from ILO Bangkok. So with that, as Christina mentioned, this session is really intended to be an interactive session. And we would like to start with a few minutes on Slido so that we can maybe collect some questions and stimulate the discussion amongst ourselves. Roberta, could you kindly share the link to the Slido?
It's already there, actually. Roberta already did it. So you'll find the Slido, the link to Slido in the chat. And for those who haven't yet worked with Slido, I mean, in Slido, you can actually send your questions in, and I would really like to encourage you to do that now in the next kind of 10 minutes. But you can not only do that, but you can also vote for questions. And basically when you vote for questions, the questions are going to move up in the Slido. And so that gives us the possibility also to address those questions which have received the most vote, meaning that they might be interesting for most of you. So I think we would really like to spend a few minutes now on Slido. So asking you to share your questions there on Slido. You will see there are already some questions mentioned there. Some are mentioned with a name, some are mentioned anonymously. So but we would really like to encourage you to put your name. So then it's also clear afterwards in the discussion, and you can kind of provide more details, or you can engage in the discussion. And maybe just to, before we maybe kind of shut up for a couple of minutes and ask you to think about the questions that are in Slido, then afterwards in the discussion, I mean, we have a number of experts here. But this is not a session where, which is kind of between the kind of experts and participants, but we would really like to engage in a discussion. So actually when we are discussing the questions afterwards, maybe before asking the experts, we would actually like to ask everyone who's in this session and maybe have others respond to those questions first, maybe by sharing experiences, or adding other aspects to the discussion, or simply kind of sharing. It might be that you've already been working on a similar challenge. You have found some solutions. So this is really about sharing those experiences. And maybe also to mention that after the session, we will have a Google document where we try to put down some of the discussions that we've had in the sessions, and also can address those the questions that we have not yet included in the discussion. So this is, and also given that there is a second session on this clinic later on, it really is also an opportunity to bring together those discussion then afterwards. So I think with that, we'd really like to invite you to go to the Slido. And Roberta has just shared with us the link. And so then maybe we shut up for a couple of minutes, mute ourselves, and give the possibility to think about your questions in Slido to vote for questions, and then we come back and have a discussion on at least some of the questions. It might be too many to respond to everything, but we would prioritize those questions which actually have received the most votes. So we're going to mute ourselves and really invite you to work on the Slido in the meantime. And I think we should maybe give ourselves, well, let's say maybe 8 minutes. So we are back in 8 minutes, which, well, in our time zone, it would be 10:20, but I think it would be very different for you in all of your time zones. So maybe let's give ourselves these 8 minutes, and then we'll be back for the discussion afterwards. So I'm looking forward to your questions in Slido. So I think maybe now that we have had a little time to enter the discussion in the slide on, I'm just looking at it, and we have a very long list of different questions that we really can discuss. And so I think that's a very interesting one. And we have a very clear leader in terms of a question that really has received the most votes in the Slido. And this question is, and you see that on very much on top of the Slido list. The question is, can you give us some good examples of countries' initiatives that have been successful in attracting informal workers in contributory schemes? And I think this is indeed a very important question. And maybe before asking our fellow experts, Luca and Laura, and I don't see Jasmina, but I think she might have a problem connecting. Before giving them a chance to come in on it, I would maybe invite some of the other participants in sharing some experience, sharing some, maybe you have been involved in designing policy solutions. So maybe if someone would like to come in on that. And please, if you want to switch on your video, I think that would be nice. So then we can really have a more personal discussion and conversation about it. So who would like to start in coming first and break the ice? Very, very quiet. So maybe we can ask some of our experts. I don't know, Laura, Luca, would you like to come in and start a discussion on that question?
I think probably Luca should lead us off, and I'll add to what he has to say.
Yes, thanks, and good morning, good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be participating in this session. I think from my side, I want to focus on the region where I work, which is in the Middle East, in the Middle East region, and really to share how indeed there have been experiences of efforts taken in extension of coverage to the informal economy. I wouldn't say necessarily all have been successful, but there are some reference points. And I think what I find useful for maybe as we kick off the discussion is to realize that the informal economy, as we define in this concept, is instead very diverse. And there is the concept of the informal economy, a great deal of different situations that require different approaches, different modalities, and different strategies for extension of coverage. So in that sense, I think there are plenty of interesting experiences around the world that kind of address specific challenges and barriers that specific subsegments of the informal economy face when it comes to accessing. It's important to realize what those barriers are, whether those barriers are more of nature of legal coverage, that there are in fact no legal provisions for inclusion of informal economy workers in social security systems, whether those barriers are more of a matters of affordability, or whether they have to do more with the matters of administration and the relationship and the accessibility of the social protection system, or the attractiveness of the benefit package. So in this sense, I think as we kick off the discussion, I want to share, I don't think I can share screen because I'm a participant. Maybe someone can help me share the screen later, maybe at the next round. I wanted to share with you some interesting work we did in Jordan, really to have some sort of a typology of what is in the informal economy, which I think can help us identify what mechanisms for for extension of coverage can be taken in different contexts. Now, going to country examples, I think I can share from the region. I will share a couple, and then I want to mention one not from the region, which I think is very interesting. Both Jordan and Oman have introduced several years back schemes that allow voluntary contributions from self-employed workers and on-account workers in the main social security system. So there is in both countries an established social security system for formal sector workers, and a special window has been opened for self-employed workers to actually contribute to the mainstream, if you want, social security systems for benefits that range from old age, invalidity pensions, unemployment, employment injury, etc. And the difference between these two cases, so in both cases, it's merging into the mainstream social security system, which I think is a question some of you have asked, is it better to have a standalone or a more integrated approach to inclusion in the social security, and we can come back to the points on that. In the case of Oman, quite generous subsidies are provided to the self-employed who join the scheme on the basis of a sliding scale that basically rewards increased contribution by self-employed on-account workers with a matching contribution from the system itself, which is funded through general solidarity across all participating members. In the case of Jordan, this kind of principle of incentive or subsidy to individual contributions is not there, so it is more left to the individual, to the choice of the individual self-employed worker to actually join in the system. But both schemes are voluntary, and I think as a result of that, take up and increasing coverage has been relatively limited, and it has been noted very much in the context of the COVID crisis how big of a coverage gap has remained as a result of these schemes operating only, let's say, on the basis of a voluntary mechanism. An interesting case I also wanted to share is the case for fisheries in Tunisia. So in recent, Tunisia has a quite interesting model. I don't know it in full detail because I don't cover Tunisia, but I recently read some of the experience of Tunisia. And what I found interesting is that in Tunisia, they have linked the participation of fishermen in the special scheme for fisheries to the issuance of the licensing that the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries has to issue to fishermen. So somehow there has been a mechanism that links participation in the social security system with other forms of engagement that informal economy workers have with government, with the public authority, in this case, from the perspective of acquiring licensing for fisheries. And I think that's an interesting avenue that can be explored, could be explored in terms of creating those synergies and aligning relationships between social security and other systems when it comes to the engagement of informal economy workers. Maybe I'll stop here, let Laura come in, and then I'll share another couple if there are no inputs from other participants in the room. Over.
I see Jasmine has arrived as well, so that's good news. So, I mean, I'll just share a couple. I mean, there are actually quite a few to choose from, more than you would think. But where you see it quite often, the kind of combination of contributory and non-contributory schemes is in health insurance. And I see somebody has commented on the chat about Nepal's national health insurance scheme. But, you know, we also see this in Indonesia with the JKN, Jaminan Kesehatan Nasional, the health insurance scheme there, and we see it with Rwanda's community-based health insurance scheme as well. So in the JKN, for example, there's three levels of contributors, depending on income, and then there's a subsidized component who come in after those three components, and they get you know, fully subsidized access to the health coverage. And that those are people who fall below the poverty line, but also some vulnerable groups in the informal economy. So I know fishermen, for example, have been designated as beneficiaries of the free health card. And the struggle always with that, though, is how low do you set the benefit? You know, I mean, that's always going to be the issue. It's the same with targeting and means testing. You know, who qualifies for the benefit? And the other thing about the JKN is it is a mandatory scheme. And talking to home-based workers who are mainly women in Indonesia, the issue there was that even though they were on the lowest tier of people having to contribute, that it was still quite a big financial burden for them. They were penalized if they weren't contributing to it. And they didn't see how, if fishermen were included in the subsidized card, you know, home-based workers weren't included as well. So their struggle was for inclusion into on the basis of occupation into the subsidy. There's also a lot of questions about the data. You know, how is the data being collected? I mean, we hear these in targeting discussions all the time, but the same issue does apply, I think, to the, you know, where you set the cutoff between the non-contributory and the contributory benefits. And I think there's probably a similar issue with the Rwandan CBHI scheme, which has achieved remarkable coverage. It's achieved 94% coverage in that country. Which is higher than a lot of other social insurance schemes have managed. But it does, again, have that subsidized component for people falling into the lowest income categories. And it does also have issues with, you know, whether it's actually financially sustainable. And that's probably also the other issue that has to be thought about with these schemes is how you keep them financially viable if you've got a large proportion of members who aren't contributing. And at the same time, keep the benefits adequate enough that people consider it worthwhile to contribute. So there are many tensions in this story, I think, that are interesting and challenging to think about. I think ultimately, though, I mean, part of ensuring that contributory schemes work is ensuring that people have higher income overall. So when we think about access to social protection, we need to be thinking about, you know, ultimately we need to be raising people's income so that they have the capacity to contribute. We've just done a small survey in 6 states in India looking at domestic workers and their access to social protection. And it's very noticeable that the only state where workers really had high access to a pension and a contributory pension was in Kerala, where 85% of the workers surveyed said they had access to a contributory pension through their domestic workers welfare boards, which are another example of contributory schemes that are relatively interesting to think about. But they also had double the income of most other domestic workers in India. So, you know, you're talking about a group of workers that actually have some contributory capacity. And I think that that's important for us to situate this issue of social insurance within that broader discussion about incomes. Thanks, Christina.
Yeah, no, thanks a lot to both Luca and Laura, because I think you really have touched upon so many important points, which are also coming also in other questions that are on our list. Maybe just before handing over to Jasmina, and then maybe also other participants would like to come in. I think just to highlight 3 points that both of you have mentioned, which we can elaborate further than in the following. I think what you mentioned about having high incomes, I think this points to really a very key point, is that we cannot just look at social protection policies in isolation. We also need to look at other policies, at economic policies, at employment, labor market policies, wage policies. I think there's a lot also with regard to the kind of the business environment, especially when we think about self-employed workers, when we think about informal enterprises. I think there's a lot which goes much beyond the social protection sphere as such. And I think this is a very important point. Then also, I think, and this is linking to what Luca mentioned for Tunisia, so the looking at the potential to link it to some other mechanism, like you mentioned for the licensing, but also being aware that this might also have some difficulties, especially for some very vulnerable categories of workers. And then the question of voluntary versus mandatory coverage. I think that might be something we come back to later on. So maybe bringing Jasmina in, and maybe Luca, actually kindly the organizers have also made you a host, so you can maybe there afterwards also share the material that you had announced. So, but maybe first going to Jasmina.
Thank you. I think for our sub-region, it's really a mixed story. It's a story of deteriorated access to social insurance, which is a result of these other policies around social protection, which are impacting on the quality of work, salaries, and the position of different groups of workers with different types of contracts or no contracts at all. But when we look at the relative success stories, I would then mention the cases of ensuring access to health insurance in Georgia and in Azerbaijan. Both countries have Georgia has completely discontinued social insurance principles and introduced general tax finance social protection programs. And actually, at some point, the majority of population was left out of access to health services. And a couple of years ago, they introduced universal health package for everyone based on estimate of their incomes. So there are different types of packages for people with different earning capacity. The more you earn, the more you have to contribute or co-pay the certain services. But basically, the people with lowest income brackets have access to the most comprehensive package, which actually meets the needs for decent healthcare. So the similar story goes for Azerbaijan, and they have introduced this only 3 years ago. So they are still building the system up. On the less positive note, what we see in this sub-region, and I think we will, or I will benefit a lot from these discussions, is this notion that since people cannot contribute, let's try and register as many people in informal sector, and let's introduce some sort of taxation, which can then be directed towards social protection. And for example, we have the most recent example in Uzbekistan, where workers' contributions have been discontinued, employers' contributions have been decreased for employers in private sector, in public sector they stay the same. Then everybody who earns some income has to pay personal income tax, and part of that personal income tax goes towards social insurance. It usually goes into the pension fund, and majority of it goes towards the pension insurance. So no one knows actually whether they are insured against the risk of unemployment, sickness. And this is these are the issues that we see more and more being discussed in this sub-region. So trying to expand the contributory base and trying to register workers in informal economy, and through this personal income tax with the share of social tax being directed somewhere where nobody's quite clear where this money goes. So it would be also interesting to hear examples of how these types of issues have been resolved in different countries, and whether there are possibilities to learn from other experiences. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Jasmina. And so maybe before going back to the other participants to add, I just wanted to give the word to Luca, because Luca wanted to share something, but now I don't see him anymore. Luca, are you still there? Or otherwise we'll come back to you later on. But maybe I think we have touched upon so many interesting issues in that discussion. So would maybe any one of the other participants want to come in on anything before we move on to the next question? No one? You're very quiet. So, but then let's maybe move to the next question, and I hand over to Quinn for that.
Thank you, Christina. So the second most voted question was, how can organizations of informal workers be involved in formulating policy solutions to improve their social protection? And indeed, that's a very, very important question. I think Laura may be best able to reply to that question, and then we can also open the floor to participants. And I see that Rachel is also in the call. So I'm giving you the floor.
Thanks, Quinn. Yeah, and my colleague Rachel Moussier is here as well, so she can definitely jump in. How you get to the point of being able to influence policy and formulating policy solutions is also a question of power, right? And how you are able to, how informal workers can kind of shift the power dynamics, which see them at the bottom and other players sort of higher up the pyramid than themselves, and actually be taken seriously by governments as sort of policy players, I guess. So part of it is about how informal workers actually get a seat at the policymaking table, right? And I think there's an interesting way of thinking about it in terms of power resources framework, which is a way of understanding how marginalized groups can influence policy in the interests of their own, you know, in their own interests. And I think there are at least three ways I can think of that we've seen informal workers, organizations of informal workers. And again, I'd like to emphasize the importance of organization here, because one informal worker is going to find it very hard to influence much, being an incredibly marginalized person. But if you have organization of informal workers, then you have many people who have much greater strength, I think. I mean, one of the things we see often in Africa is informal worker organizations trying to use what we'd call institutional power through alliances with formal trade unions. Very often, either informal worker organizations are part of formal trade unions or they have an alliance with a formal trade union. And those formal trade unions are represented in tripartite spaces where they, you know, have access to policymakers, are consulted about policy, and at least, although, I mean, it's questionable as to the extent to which trade unions have power to influence policies, they certainly have a lot more power than informal worker organizations. So, for example, in Rwanda, the trade union of informal workers uses very much the formal trade unions to put forward their demands in the sort of national tripartite spaces. So there they're using the kind of spaces that have been set up within the state and institutionalized within the state to allow workers some voice. I would say there's also what we call associational power. So organizations which are very big, they have a lot of numbers, they have the ability to run their own services for their members. So here we're thinking of big organizations like the Self-Employed Women's Association in India, or UTEP, the Excluded Workers Movement in Argentina. They have the capacity to run their own mutual schemes, social protection schemes, workers' health services. You know, they run big schemes for their members. And through doing that, have gained quite a lot of knowledge about what works on the ground for informal workers, right? So do you get called into policy spaces because they have that knowledge, and they feel it's something that, you know, governments acknowledge that there's something they might be able to learn from those organizations. And we've certainly seen that with SEWA being able to influence the design of some of the national health policies that have been implemented in India, being called in as almost expert consultants in how you would reach informal workers. And then I think thirdly, there's what we'd call social power. So small, you know, but particularly for smaller organizations of informal workers, this is another route to leverage alliances with other civil society actors who might be able to help them create policy influence. So I'm thinking of HomeNet Thailand, for example, is a relatively small organization of informal workers, 7,000 members of home-based workers, but it uses alliances with other civil society groups, you know, what they call people's organizations in Thailand, to boost its power to influence the policy agenda in their interests, whether that's with disability rights networks, formal trade unions, networks of the poor, you know, wherever they see the opportunity to create these alliances, that's the space that they move into. So I think it's, you know, different organizations will use different strategies depending on what's available to them. And what their own sort of organizational capacities are.
Sorry, if I may add to that, there are nice examples of association of domestic workers being supported by a gender machinery in the government in Uzbekistan. So there is this big women's committee that supports inclusion of women in social, political, and economic life. And basically they took up the interests of domestic workers to put them higher on the government's agenda. And given that the gender machinery has links with trade unions, so there is a spillover of this of the demands and requests from those domestic workers that goes then through different levels of association and different types of representation. And one of the examples of stronger support from or stronger alliances between trade unions and informal workers has been from Georgia recently, because the government has come up with this one-off program enabling workers in informal economy access unemployment benefits during the crisis. So they had to register as informal workers. So it was sort of a self-identification and enabling them to access unemployment benefits. However, apparently bureaucracy was an administration was huge, and some were questioning whether this amount of one-off benefit pays off for the time that you have to spend in sorting out all the papers. So the formal trade unions actually were the ones that were demanding the system to work better, administration to be reduced, extend unemployment benefits, think about having it on a more regular basis. So this was somewhere where actually formal trade unions themselves were really proactive and found that they have to represent the interests of workers in the informal economy.
Many thanks, Laura and Yasmina. I saw that Rachel raised her hand, so I'll be giving Rachel the floor directly.
Hi, everyone. I just wanted to quickly add to the points that Laura and Jasmina have made, just in the context of COVID and the opportunities that we're seeing in terms of building institutional, associational, and societal power. As Laura mentioned, I think informal workers' organizations in some contexts have been very important to governments to collect, to identify people who are in need of support through these sort of emergency cash transfers. And so sometimes for the first time, we are seeing this engagement between social security or social protection agencies in a country and informal workers' organizations. And I think that's positive. We're also seeing the emergence of, as have been noted elsewhere, the COVID-19 solidarity funds, and this coming together of different social protection agencies within a country or ministries within a country and donors and civil society and workers' organizations. And I think this could be a way to also reimagine the space that informal workers have in these discussions around social protection, where they are often excluded from social security conversations because they are either not represented by trade unions or do not have direct representation, even if they are represented by trade unions. Or that they are excluded from social assistance discussions because those are really targeted at civil society representing children rights groups or people living with disabilities, etc. So, you know, the institutionalization of some of these solidarity funds, could that open the space for a more representative participation of informal workers? And then I think finally, just a last point, we have seen for some informal workers organizations that membership numbers have been increasing because they see the value now of organizing partly to access social protection measures. So I think that's also something promising for the future. I don't want to exaggerate that because on the other hand, many informal workers are losing their employment. And so organizations, are seeing that their members can no longer continue working, and therefore organizations are also breaking down. So there's both things are happening at the same time. But I just wanted to add that.
Thank you, Rachel. I saw Luca just joined again. Luca, would you like to add something?
No, not specifically on this question.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for maybe to all the participants. I'm seeing there are many participants from different agencies, but also country representatives. Do you have any good examples, or would you like to share any challenges you see in your country? I mean, I think what came out of the interventions of all the experts so far is that there are indeed challenges to include informal workers organizations, but at the same time, the COVID crisis has shown that it's quite important to include them, not only in the policy making, but also in the implementation. And we've seen that they can play an important role in facilitating the extension of social protection, be it that they facilitate the registration process or they facilitate contribution collection. In some cases, they can also take the intermediary role of an employer where there's none. So, and I mean, there are quite some good country examples, such as in the Dominican Republic or in Latin America. Maybe we have some participants who would like to share their experiences. If you would like, you can also do it via chat. And otherwise, I would suggest to move to the next question.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, thanks a lot, Quinn. Maybe if I can take over again, but we have only 5 minutes for the next question. Which is a very short time, but let's maybe make the best of it. And I think the question which received the kind of the next highest number of votes was the question of trade-offs between mandatory and voluntary contributory schemes for informal workers and the practical examples. And I mean, what we have seen, and maybe Oscar also asking Luca to come in on that in a moment. And because you had mentioned examples, I think it was from Oman and Jordan, basically for some social insurance schemes that were opened to self-employed workers to contribute voluntarily. And maybe if you could quickly come in and possibly also share the material that you had mentioned. And also asking about, because I mean you had mentioned also specific incentives, because I think what we've seen from many countries is really that although many countries there is a possibility of joining voluntarily a social insurance scheme, this possibility is quite often not being taken up by many workers. So I mean, quite rarely we see a significant extension of coverage through voluntary mechanisms. And I think one of the critical points here is certainly the question of whether the workers really perceive the benefit package as something which is really relevant to them and which is adapted to their needs. But there might also be issues of trust. So maybe Luca, if you want to very quickly share with us the experience from Oman and Jordan and what you wanted to show us earlier.
Yes, thank you, Christina. And it's true that time is short and the questions are complex, but I guess the one slide I wanted to share, I find useful, going back to the point we were making about the diversity of circumstances in the informal economy and therefore the need to develop solutions and mechanisms for extension of coverage that are somehow tailored to the characteristics of workers in the informal economy. I hope you can see the screen. This is just a snapshot of the informal economy in Jordan. So we basically mapped out who are workers according to the labor force survey who lack access to social security. Here we're talking about social insurance. And really you can see them mapped in two ways, by sector and by employment arrangement and by nationality. I mean, first striking finding is that the largest share of informal economy workers are non-Jordanians, but also that really they have very different employment relationship. They work under very different employment relationship. They're not only on account workers, but there is a large share of informal economy workers or unregistered workers who are employees, permanent employees or short-term employees, only in a smaller segment of the labor market we have informal economy workers who work casually. So really it is to say that for all of these different categories, different approaches can be developed and built. And voluntary schemes have been utilized primarily in certain countries for on-account workers, for the employers. The matter of voluntarily really underlines another fundamental problem, which is that of affordability and attractiveness of the social security system. And so in that sense, as Christina was saying, we have seen many countries taking the route of voluntary schemes, basically not to overburden workers with low income capacity with too high contribution rates, which as a result leads to problems of self-selection into the scheme, adverse selection into the scheme, and low coverage, particularly amongst the most vulnerable workers who need most these schemes. So that's how countries, for example, Jordan is, as we speak, in the in the middle of a conversation to turn its voluntary scheme for the self-employed into a mandatory scheme, but at the same time to acknowledge the need to target and focus access to core benefits or to the most essential benefits, recognizing matters of affordability with the retirement benefits and focusing the mandatory coverage primarily on issues of unemployment protection, employment injury protection, maternity, and therefore with a stronger focus on short-term benefits rather than long-term benefits, which is one of the dimensions that Christina was referring to. So I guess the message here is that the informal economy, very diverse, different employment arrangements within that require different measures. Not all have to do with own account workers. In many cases, there are issues of non-compliance or limited compliance by the employers, and therefore different strategies are required. And that the matter of voluntary versus mandatory should be seen maybe more from the perspective of how to ensure affordability in accessing to these schemes, and therefore how to devise mechanisms of subsidization, and therefore how that subsidization should take place within the social security system and from general taxation to ensure that all workers, not only those who want and can participate, actually have access to those schemes. Over and back to you, Christine.
Yeah, thank you so much, Luca. And I think that really raises, again, more questions. And unfortunately, we're at the end of our session. We're already over time. So I would really like to thank everyone who was actively participating in that discussion, and really invite you, and we'll put the link to the Google document also on the page of that clinic. So I would really invite those who haven't had the time or the opportunity to speak, maybe also add to that document and share their experiences. And maybe also, if you can join us for the second session, we're going to continue the discussion later today. So I think that has been an extremely interesting and fruitful discussion, although we have really, I think we have opened many more questions than actually answered them. But I think that's a good thing, because I think this is really one of the biggest challenges that is in front of us. And I think finding solutions and having that kind of conversation is extremely important. So thanks to all of you, and maybe join us for the later session, and also please also contribute to the discussions in the other sessions. And I've also put the link to our joint booth, where you find some material from ILO and WIGO on that topic. So thank you, everyone, and maybe see you later this afternoon for the second session. Thank you very much, and goodbye.
Thank you.